Hello and welcome to another episode of Convos and Chill. Man, I just want to take a moment and just tell you guys happy holidays, happy Eid. I hope you guys had fun with your folks, with your family, with your loved ones. I wish all the best for you guys and most importantly, health and prosperity for all of you guys. And man, today, episode 24. We came this far. We are on episode 24, man. This is crazy. This is super crazy for me. I mean, I have ton of content coming your way, and it's going to be crazy, and I'm so happy that I'm sharing this here with you guys. So thank you very much for whoever is tuning in. I love you all. Do share some love with me. Share the video with your friends. Share it on your timeline, and let them know about the page. And sorry, I forgot to introduce myself. My name is Ahmed, for the guys who know me, aka Dirty. And this show is regarding me and my guests clicking on topics that we share the same interest, and we talk about it over a cup of tea. And for tonight's guest, oh man, this guy, he been off radar for a while. Then I come to know that he's a legit rapper, like a proper like rapper. And he been releasing videos and songs left and right, and I'm so excited to talk to him. And as you know, same as anyone else, he had a rough patch in his life. So we're going to be talking about how he started this whole thing and how he got into the game. And we're going to, you know, kind of, we're going to be like, you know, having an educational theme type of session. But it's going to be regarding his journey with his music and how he got here. So tonight's session's guest is Hadi Opeña Rushdie. He's one of my old school friends. I actually met him through another friend. And since then, he was off radar. We were not in touch, but now I found him and he's doing well. So without any further ado, Hadi, welcome to the show, man. How's everything, bro?
Thank you, sir. It was a nice introduction. Everything is fine. Congratulations on your milestone and on your podcast. Awesome to be here, bro.
Thank you very much, man. Dude, it's all the pleasure is mine. I mean, it's freaking good to see you back in action, man. I've never knew you're a rapper, bro.
Yes, sir.
So,
yes,
so give us a tiny backbone to your whole story, man. Where are you from? How you been? How's everything? How you been coping up with the pandemic, man?
Pandemic's actually been pretty crazy. I don't know if people are watching from the Middle East, but it's sort of lax now, although the numbers are still kind of staggering. Mm-hmm. But for me, it's been a dream come true because I'm just staying in and creating content, which is basically what I want to do with my life. And so it's been good in terms of content creation, but of course there's so many people that have been losing their jobs and can't go out and see people, and crazy times, weird times, but we're managing. I'm staying with my family currently. I was supposed to be back in the States a month and a half ago, but everything got pushed back, and so sort of stuck, which is okay because, you know, I'm in safe hands. And also, you asked for like a backstory to everything that I'm doing. So I'm basically
who's Hadi? Because I'm right. Sure people don't know you. So introduce yourself in your own words.
Sure. So I'm what you call ethnically ambiguous. My father is Egyptian German, and my mom is from the Philippines. I was born in the UAE, and I left here at 16 to go live in the Philippines by myself. It started off with friends. It was supposed to be for vacation, and then I ended up just staying there because it was not here. And I spent 8 years in the Philippines. So I finished off my studies and started off the first years of my adulthood working random jobs. And I was always in the field of entertainment, always in the performing arts industry. And I built a small career for myself as an MC. So somebody that's on stage during an event. So I always had a microphone in my hands, and performing has always been like something I did since I was a little kid. And it started off with just like talent for commercials and photo shoots here in Dubai. And I kind of dabbled in everything, which was something that I was kind of known for, I guess, when I was younger. Just I did everything I could get my hands on, and I tried to be the best at whatever I tried. And music was something that was like, it was more of a, it wasn't a hobby, it was just something that I could do, but never took seriously because of how it's viewed, you know, over here on this side of the world, and it wasn't something that really pushed me into thinking that I could do something with it. And so, but then when I traveled to the Philippines, I performed more over there, kind of opened doors for me as an entertainer. And then after 8 years in the Philippines, I went back to the original plan, which was to try and live in the States. And so I left for the States in 2014. I've been back and forth ever since. And because of the whole visa situation, I'd stay there for 6 months and back. So I tried to figure things out while I was over there. And music was something that was super accidental. This was my second or third stay. I was in New York City. I told you this story last night. It was really, really by accident. Somebody had tagged me in a video on Facebook. A producer had posted a 20-second beat, and he captioned it, "Tag somebody who you think can kill this beat." And a college friend of mine from the Philippines, which was super random, tagged me in the post and said, "You could totally kill this beat." And I just had, super fun with it. It was really silly. It was a 20-seconder, and then I posted it, and I messaged this producer who had tens of thousands of followers at the time. So I had no expectations at all. And as soon as I messaged him, he replies back seconds after and says, "Bro, send me this video on my email. I'm gonna post it, you're about to blow up." And I had no idea what the hell he was talking about. I was in the States trying to perform, do acting and stuff like that. So I had no idea what the hell was going on. So I sent him the song, and he posted on his page, and just like he said, it kind of blew up. So I was in New York City, and I think he was I don't know if he was in the East Coast, in Atlanta or somewhere. And it kind of blew up for a couple of weeks. It had tens of thousands of views and so many comments from all these people who lived in the States and who were following him on his page. And it was 98%, I want to say 98% positive comments. Who is this artist? This is the kind of music I want to hear. So it was it was an epiphany that I had that one night in New York, and I was just shit, this seems so much easier. Let me just do music, because everything is online anyways, and there's more access to me and the stuff that I can do if I did that. And so for the past, and so this was 2015, early 2016, and so it's been 4 years now that I've been actively chasing music, and I think I've I can't really say for myself, it sounds weird when I say it, but I've established a name for myself, sort of. Just amongst peers and people who know what I can do as a music person. So weird for me to say artist, but so this is what I've been doing for the past 4 years. I've just been creating content and lots of music. And
That's great, man. That's great, man. This is such an introduction, man.
Pretty big introduction, yeah.
Yeah, we're gonna be talking about how you initially, you've told us that you got in touch with the producer and that whole 20-second beat or whatever, you took that challenge up, and we're gonna be talking about all that. I just want to give a shout out to the guys who are commenting. Natasha Jack is saying, "You're amazing, Hadi." Brent Rivera is in the house. What's up, bro? He's saying, "Brap, big ups, man."
Astusha and Brent, thanks for watching, you guys.
Yeah, man. We got lovely people over here. Thank you very much, guys, for tuning in. If you're kind enough, share this video with your friends. Share some love. Man, sorry if I stammer sometimes, because I'm new to this thing. It's not new. It's not an excuse, but I'm getting there. I'm like working my way up there, man, you know? So share some love with us. Share the video with your friends. Let them know about this page so we can get more traffic into the page so we can create more content for you guys. So, Hadi, man, hit it a bit more back. How was your, what was the first introduction of you to the rap music? Or, as you said, you were an actor. You're an actor as well. So, which one was first? Was the acting first or was the music? And if it was each one of them, what was the first interaction?
So it was basically performing as a whole that was first. And when I was younger, I don't know how old I was. It was definitely under 8 years old when there were probably three or four major companies that were, the advertisements and shoots and stuff like that. And I was a cast member for one of the agencies, and it started off with I think it was a photo shoot, and then I got called for a commercial, and then they realized that I was just such an active kid with a huge imagination, and we had no idea where, you know, to put that kind of energy. And so that when all those things started happening, it seemed like a really good fit. And so yeah, so I have a very loud personality for those that do know me. Mm-hmm. And so that was pretty much, it made sense that I was in the performing industry.
Which is good, man.
Which is really good. And then music was super, you know, people from the Middle East don't have similar stories or backgrounds when it comes to music, because we weren't, I'll say I'm a 90s kid, I was born in 89. Mm-hmm. So we weren't as exposed, and we didn't have enough reach in terms of being exposed to music from the outside world. Everything that was shown to us was what we had. And so we had the radio, we had the music video channels. And so it was really random. Like we met, this is probably in 2016, but we didn't know each other like way back.
Yeah.
So like rock was pretty much the scene here in the 2000s, right?
Mm, which it still a bit is.
Yeah, I think it's, if anything, I think it's one of the main, it's a constant in terms of like, you know, music genres that are followed in the Middle East.
Yeah, because there's a tiny community behind it, and they're actually like, you know, working their
asses.
Yeah,
they push it. Yeah. So like, I was super influenced by my friends when I was younger. I didn't have a genre or a taste in music that I actually consider myself like a fan of. I would just listen to whatever I heard, and if I liked it, then I liked it.
Mm-hmm.
And then I think I was like 14, I got introduced to the same circles that we know, mm-hmm. a bunch of friends that we had, and I was always the youngest in the group, and so I sort of just really easily influenced, and everybody loved rock, and so I initially just started listening to all the music that they were listening to. I can't name all the artists and their albums that I heard. Everything was just so random.
Mm-hmm.
I remember it started with like, there was Judas Priest, Three Days Grace, Chevelle.
Nice. You know, like the, nice. I love Chevelle. Then, I love Chevelle.
And then there were the gigs here, and I was never exposed to gigs. And so I just kind of went with it. And then I had I don't know if you, do you know Muzumo? Have you
Who?
Met Muzumo?
Man. I'm pretty sure if you've seen.
One of my super, super dear close friends, and took care of me a lot when I was younger. Again, like I was the youngest in all, most of my friend groups. And he kind of like, he got me into drumming. And so I eventually somehow I managed to get a drum set, and I had a drum set in my house in Sharjah, which was really weird. And
yeah.
like music kind of just started playing a part in things that I would do around that age. And so, and drumming of course was something that I just fell in love with, and that's when beats come in and like rhythm, and then so you know I'm building my musicality as a child, and then hip hop was super random. This was during tape players, so like you know you had the
Walkmans. Yeah man.
So I don't know how I came across, there was like a mixtape or something. It was like a volume of just like two sides of different rap songs of like random groups, and I can't even remember. Like, so there was definitely some Wu-Tang, some Pac, and some Biggie. I can't recall any of the names or of the songs. I just remember like, okay, so this is like hip. This is a genre of music. This is like, there's a beat and it's like, there's a rhythm. And so I was like, okay. And I kind of like started swaying to it. So I was like, okay, I like hip hop. And so 14, 15, videos start coming in. We have all these. Like,
MTV, you know, like, and all these. Yeah.
And we have these like internet, there was this platform, and where now it's like you have Instagram and TikTok and all these things where you can watch random videos, but there was this platform where you could just watch random videos.
Mm-hmm.
Anyways, and so like beatboxing was a huge thing.
Yeah, right? Man. Yes.
Yeah. So it was really big. And then I remember one of my other friends from the main group that I had growing up, his name is Basil, Big Bass. I don't know if he's around, if you know him. But he beatboxes also, and we both could beatbox. We found out that we could beatbox. So whenever we were like at a house party, or like if we were just chilling, just the guys.
You guys had to throw it out. Yeah, you guys had to throw it.
Yeah, beatbox, and then like freestyle was a thing. And then like I remember my first time getting introduced. This was like people used to hang out at Dera City Center.
Parking lots. Yes, right? Yes. On the Virgin, super, Virgin mega stores.
Super, super cringe, right?
Cringe.
And they come in with their FUBU clothes and their baggy jeans.
Oh my God, FUBU, FUBU, man. I had a FUBU shirt, but I bought it from Karama, and it was some legit stuff, man.
You gotta frame that. That's epic shit. So like, people would freestyle, and I was like. And it was like, back then, of course, you know, you're exposed to it for like the first few times. It's like, oh shit, this is cool. Like, urban culture. Oh,
yeah.
Shit, you know? And I'm like commuting from Sharjah, and like, I'm just all the way to Dubai just to hang out with the guys. And it was really bad for me. It's really bad, right? But it was something that was like new. And so I was just like, hey, this is pretty cool. And so whenever we hung out with friends, I found that I could freestyle quite easy, actually. And it wasn't like the best. I wasn't like throwing down like hard metaphors or bars, but I could rhyme things pretty easily. And it would seem like something fun to do whenever we were at a house party or all the groups were together, and people would just look at me like, oh, freestyle something. And so like, my friend would beatbox, and I would just like make some stupid rhymes up. And so that became a thing. And so that's how freestyle and rap and hip hop kind of just like infused with everything that I was doing. And so from there, you know, just add on a bunch of experiences, and then living in the Philippines, and then like, you know, all that kind of just, you know, and my views on things, it just created this kind of like personality that I am right now. And then leaving the Philippines, and the rest is pretty much history, I guess. So,
I mean, we're gonna dig deep a bit deeper to find out how hard was it for you to, you know, get back on track regarding these things because of this whole. Back and forth.
I'm not even sure if I'm on the right. Am I supposed to be on the Zoom app right now, or am I supposed to be on Facebook?
Be on the Zoom one.
Zoom one. Cool. So we're good.
Yeah. Because there's a delay between the Zoom, because it's a stream, so it's gonna be like a 30-second delay. So
just in case I cuss.
No, it's fine, man. I mean,
I'm kidding.
Yeah. So I just want to jump back to the comment section. The guys are on fire. Ramsey is saying. He's just saying say hi to Natasha. What's up? What's good? And Aryan is saying say hello to Hadi for me. And Ramzi
hello,
saying
hello, Aryan. Which Aryan is this?
Aryan. I think he's an Iranian person. Aryan Kazemi.
Okay. What's up, Aryan? You have to change the way you said it. You know, just.
I mean, that's the Iranian way to say it, Kazemi.
Gotcha.
I'm a Persian as well, so I understand. So Ramzi's saying, sup, Hadi, let's make an MMK episode about your life, which that's going to be good, man. I mean, you should do some stuff like this, man. I mean, it's good for your resume. As in, you know, maybe you can act it out and stuff like this. Maybe you can put like a scenario and a dialogue into it and stuff. It's going to be crazy. So moving on, Ramzi is like, you know, they're talking together. And Zara Lee, thank you very much, Zara Lee. She's saying, I love your show. So inspiring. Thank you very much. That's what I'm trying to do. Thank you very much for the kind words, Zara. And Natasha is giving us emojis and stuff like this. So, man, can you, like, we heard almost like, you know, a bit of your struggle, like how you got into the thing and the whole freestyling. And I remember, man, back in the days, the gatherings and DCC and all these childish things that we used to do, man. I mean, you know, as you said, I met you through other friends, and when I look at it now, man, we know a lot of people, and somehow I found out that, you know, some of my friends that I came to know during my travels, they're kind of connected with the people that I knew here. So, you know, I'm trying to say, like, you know, the connection that we make, it's kind of like it's a short circuit, and we can find each other easily. And because of our huge ass gang, like, you know, Vic, Daoud, and all these guys, I met you. And, you know, first session, we were just sitting and chilling. You're a freaking cool dude, man. Like, very chilled. Very chilled. And I like I always said, man, you remind me of one of my friends. I think you know him, Sultan.
Sultan.
You know, the local dude. I mean, maybe you've seen him, because he is in the crew. Like, you know, the other guys.
I will take this moment and apologize in advance to any names that I seem to not remember. I'm horrible with shit like that. Just letting you guys know. But if I see your face, I'll know who you are. I'll probably remember.
I'm sure Brent knows Sultan as well. So Brent is saying, "Want push? Hadi got push. What that means?
Say that again.
Want push? Hadi got push.
Do you want push? Hadi got push?
Yeah.
It can mean a number of things.
Brent,
I got the hype. If you want the
Brent, can you elaborate on the comment? So, man, I mean, back to the topic, like, so.
I'm trying to share the page on Instagram.
I'm
listening though.
Yep. So what I wanted to tell you is, like, you know, as us growing up, and, like, you know, because of our backgrounds, because of our, you know, our families and the beliefs and all these things, we, as you said, we just kind of learned it through the TV that, you know, music is like this. We got used to the music. We got through, like, you know, rap, hip hop, and like metal, like all these genres, or, you know, these type of music, but we never understood where is it coming from. So how hard was it for you to literally, like, you know, get into the game, as in
not
to
so hard.
Like, literally not so hard, as in, like, that you didn't have any struggles?
I definitely had, no, of course there's struggles in the journey, but I'm just answering the question on, like, the difficulty level of me kind of just jumping into whatever it is I'm doing. So there's a lot to talk about when it comes to that, because people don't know what life is like in the Middle East. And
like, how hard, sorry to cut you off, how hard was it for you to get along with whatever was there as our background? And
right, so that's what I meant. Yeah. This is something that's super hard to explain, because I think it's a combination of how you're raised, what your brain chooses to, like, you know, accept the information that it chooses to keep, the influences and how effective the influences are in your life. And as the best way I could explain it is, my mind and my personality gravitated towards that culture. So naturally, and for people that don't know this, if you're born here and you're not of local descent, you're not considered from here. Right, so off the bat, when you're born here, you're already kind of lost. You don't have complete identity. So an identity crisis is, it's cliche, but this is the life of most of the kids that grow up here, because you have your parents' culture, you have the culture where you're born in, and then you have the culture that you follow along with your friends and your peers. So, you know, that goes without saying, we're all third culture kids. And so eventually we tend to choose the cultures that we sort of, you know, feel we have more in common with, or we're, you know, that we are attracted to by nature. And for me, it's just the sense of humor, the way of speaking, and just the way of doing things, the creativity, and just the amount of freedom that the Western world would showcase throughout all the things that came out, like through music or films, even books and stuff. I just felt more attracted towards that culture. And I felt I could speak that language much easier, which is, like, in one of my songs, I mentioned how is it I can speak a language so fluently without being exposed to it. So that, you know, so in a sense, it doesn't make any sense, but because we are, I think we're just born sponges in that sense. So we have to just kind of, like, absorb whatever it is that's, you know, given to us. And then I think we kind of just choose from there. And for me, it was just no question. That's the culture that I identified with the most, absolutely the most. Like, when I'm here, I'm not knocking on anybody, nor am I, like, calling out people or saying anything about, you know, how the culture is over here. I was never on par with the mentality and the sense of humor over here. I'm not disrespecting it. I'm just saying I felt like an outsider all the time, because I kind of just saw above them in that sense. Yeah, like, I could see different things. And in order for me to actually, you know, like, maybe get with the humor or, like, join in on conversations, I always personally felt like I had to restrain myself. So that's the best way I could explain that. So if you're, you know, if you're a baby and you're born and you're given a bunch of material, you'll know that material. And that's, to me, that became my identity. I identify most with that kind of culture. And so when I got there for the first time, I was 24 years old. I was a grown man. Well, I was a young man, a young adult when I first got to the States. And my first week in the States, this was in New York City. I'd never felt more home in my life. And I try to explain the story to so many people, and it's hard to explain it because you've never set foot in an area, and yet you feel most home there. It's hard to explain, but I think people or individuals from the Middle East can maybe put that together a little faster than others, because you don't know what your identity is until you bump into something that makes the most sense to you. And so when I was in New York City, it just made the most sense to me. I talked with people naturally. I understood the jokes naturally, the sense of humor. Mm-hmm, everybody had the same sense of wanting to accomplish something, the freedom of expression over there, because I'm somebody that talks a lot, and I'm somebody that thinks a lot as well. And I speak my mind all the time, which is why it was so hard for me to grow up over here, because mm-hmm. we all know that it's not, I don't know how to say it without sounding
bad. Exactly. I know. I'm sure the viewers get the point as well. Yeah.
Yeah. So, I couldn't be held back in that sense. And so when I got to the States, it was so natural. The only thing that kept me from staying was the fact that I wasn't born there. So my struggle for the past 6 years has been trying to build a foundation for myself in a place where I feel most comfortable.
Mm-hmm.
Which I feel should never be the case for any kind of individual, or any child for that matter. If you feel like a place is home, and it should be made accessible or easy for you to, I don't know how to explain it, but so that's been my struggle for the past 6 years, really.
Mm-hmm.
I say that as I try to post a link on my
are you
on
still
my Instagram.
You still didn't find a way to do it.
No, I shared the countdown, and then I shared the live on my Facebook. Mm. Now I'm trying to get the link and put it on my profile on Instagram.
Okay.
So you can just
copy the link and go to your bio and just put it in your bio. While you're doing that, I'll just go through the comments. And Brent is saying, oh yeah, Z is in the house. Ziad, what's up, man? Thank you very much for tuning in, bro. Ziad is saying, want to buy some push?
Okay.
And Brent, he's saying he doesn't give up. Exactly, man. You should not give up. And Ziad is making a very good point. Is saying magic of music being a universal language, experiencing transcends culture. Culture coming. Let me read it again. Magic mm-hmm. of music being a universal language, experiences transcend culture, coming from the cliched identity culture crew.
Transcends, definitely 100% transcends culture. It's the same thing goes with sports or humor. I mean, there's so many forms of I always have a hard time saying art. There's so many forms of art that kind of mm-hmm. just transcends, breaks all those barriers and keeps, because it's like you're wearing the Adidas jacket, that's a it's like a retro jacket, that's not part of the culture here, but then you know what I'm saying?
So it's much more of like a trend. It's just
an art form or a fashion that you kind of identify yourself with. So yeah, it definitely transcends. That's true what your friend said.
So what you think, man? Let's hit it and watch one of your music videos, which is a lyric video of your one of your most recent songs called My Nightmare.
Yeah.
So
sure.
So guys,
out on all platforms.
Yeah. So guys, this is one of his most recent songs called My Nightmare. So enjoy it.
Okay. Guess I'm just gonna have to talk about it. This is my nightmare. Thought I just might share with everyone out there. Listen close, pay attention, here it goes. Little boy in a car with his fam on his way to school. Driving past hella buses with them bars, ain't no kids in view. He sees men in blue. No, it's not a spin-off. He senses something cruel, feeling of impending doom. Nothing he can really do but feel it. They looking at him now, eyes screaming something loud. Pigs in a slaughterhouse, boy trying to figure out what's going on, what's going on. Chains are invisible but pain is not. Buildings get built in the heat of the sun. Bunk beds are filled, only one pot to piss in. The suicide rate's either hidden or missing. If you speak your mind then you go into prison. This little boy learned if he asked too much questions, then trouble would come and take him out the system. So best look away, little boy never mentioned these blues. never ever mention these blues. Okay. This is my nightmare. Thought I just might share with everyone out there. Listen close, pay attention, here it goes. Young women wearing uniforms hidden within walls where they screams can't be heard and they tears always fall.
Sit on the floor, never go out. Wife ain't at home, take off your clothes. You cannot fly, I have the documents, don't you dare cry. You cannot run from this, this is your life. Eat only shit, clean up the shit. Live in the dark, you piece of shit. Go get the stick, try to resist. Be fucking thankful that we let you live. You are an animal, our little bitch. Oh, you got family, who gives a shit? Oh, you want money to send to your kids? Bitch, I ain't honoring nothing you say. Why don't you get it, bitch, you are my slave. I bought your life, now you do as I say.
So shut the fuck up. I wake up. Wait, was I even asleep? I sit up slowly. Was that even a dream? Look, let me tell you what the real nightmare is. People walking all around aware of all this. Blind eyed and they post about awareness. But other people outside of our areas. Just say you scared, motherfucker, I say that. Talk about the world is unfair, you the fakest. Bring the same energy, I dare you. In your own vicinity, how dare you? Talk about the problems of another when there's people right in front of you that suffer on a daily. Oh, that's right, it's cause your life pretty dandy. As long as you ain't critical about where you stayed in, you can be critical about other places. Bullshit. I think that's bullshit. You have a house, you have a car. As long as you play by the rules, you go far. As long as you keep them out shut, then you fine. Just look away when you see something vile. You're here to get paid and to have a good time. So why do you try to speak up on crimes that happen outside when you're living one life? Why do you lie? Why don't you cry for the people inside? Why don't you try to speak up through your lines? Why can't you put out a message that's hidden? I guarantee people around will soon get them. The fuck aren't you sick and like, how can you mention some shit about how fucking depressing the world is when clearly you don't seem affected by victims around you? Huh? Let me tell you why. You are poor in mind. You do what you do to help you sleep more safe at night. Safe from people's judgments. Funny cause you judge them. Them who don't feel what you feel. How'd that make you different? We all hypocrites. I'm the same as you. But at least I don't go barking up trees that are outside of my danger zone. That's just fucking cold. But who am I to tell you what to do with what you know? There are lanes in this race. Don't get mad just cause other people's lanes ain't the same. That shit lame, yo. Life is a bitch, yo. The plane gonna crash, yo. Remember the mask though. You first, then. Otherwise you finna struggle with helping the others. So stick to the plan, yo.
This is my nightmare.
So Hadi, we heard the track. So give us an insight. What was the thought process behind this track? And what's the... What is the video image, man? It's so scary.
I like to think it's pretty self-explanatory. But let's just say it's a nightmare that I have often. And like the song suggests, sometimes I feel like people and their concerns are a little outside of where I personally think they should be. Which is, you know, again, just an opinion also.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, it's just a dream that I have, you know, quite a few times. And I think this is pretty much one of the most serious songs that I put out, in where I try to maybe say a message metaphorically or just through the lyrics. But for those that do understand it or that do, you know, mess with it, I appreciate it. I don't mean to... Oh, here's a great thing to say. I don't mean to cause any rifts with the song. It's just basically an emotion that I've been keeping for such a long time, and I felt like I had to just put it out there in the coolest way possible, which is the song. And so, yeah, the picture is just basically me and... I have this piece of cloth that kind of prevents me from talking about my nightmare. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I think that's the best way I could explain that.
I mean, like when we were talking off air, you told me this is one of your most hardcore songs that you ever done, and you were kind of hesitant of showing it, as in like you thought it would like send a like the well, wrong
for obvious reasons. I mean, if somebody hasn't, if no one, if there's a person watching that's never listened to my music and that's the first song they hear, it might be a little too much. I will say that. You know, if ever I'm introducing myself to somebody or my content, I would have picked something a little lighter. Mm-hmm. But this is something that's pretty it's pretty serious and close to my heart. So, but you get a full taste of the kind of person I am just through that song.
Yeah, man. I mean, dude, in my opinion, is one of your most you know, like you remember when I contacted you, I was like, dude, this song is legit, and you know, I want to showcase this as one of your things, one of your, because it's one of the most recent ones as well. But again, it has that message, and it's like, you know, that ambient stuff that I like, you know, I can connect to easily. So yeah. I mean, here you go, you have a fan over here from like just because of this song. And dude, kudos to you, you did a great job. The whole picture resembles the you know, the text and the vibe of saying, you know, welcome to my nightmare, you know, it's like, you know, it really really reflects, and it gives that charisma and that image to the listener that they can imagine and they can feel it.
Yeah.
So
I'm glad you feel that way.
Yeah? Yeah, man, dude, I mean, come on, man, as artists we always thrive to, you know, to give that image, to, you know, try to, you know, how to say, to let them picture what we are seeing in our brains, you know.
Sure.
Why am I using such childish words? You know, just to, you know, to let them picture what we're going through throughout our art and, like, you know, or like, you know, music or like a piece of digital art or whatever. Even with our food, we can, like, you know, transfer that type of emotion. So this is a very good example of, like, you know, letting your anger talk by itself through music. And in my opinion, one of the best things you've ever done. So
thank you,
man, that's great. I mean, you need to keep doing these type of things. And so do you guys want to hear a lighter one? As he said, like, I'm gonna be playing one of his oldest ones. So we're gonna listen to Stray Dog. This is one of your earlier stuff. Yeah
this was a year and a half, a couple years ago, actually. A couple years ago.
So before going to the video, Brent is putting fire emojis and you know, Natasha is saying this is one of my favorites. And Brent is saying last time I actually rapped was because Hadi made me. Wow.
Oh,
what,
man.
A story, man. Tell me. I now I want to know it.
I got to tell you that story. Yeah, no, me and Brent actually put out a very fire track.
Really?
Out a fire track.
When?
Yeah.
When was it?
Years. This is like when we were both living in the Philippines, because we both chilled here and in the Philippines.
Nice.
So we had the same circle friend. And this was like a long time ago. This is, we were just messing around. I even remember the name of the track. It's called Haters Games, if I'm not mistaken.
Okay.
And Brent had a fire verse. Mine was like, eh. So Brent had a fire verse, and I can't find, I'm sure it's somewhere. It's like in one of my hard drives, because I remember it was on my PC, it was on my desktop back in the Philippines.
Never knew Brent was a rapper. Rapper?
Listen,
Brent?
Listen, I don't know if you know, man. That boy's talented. Don't let him. We feed his ego a little bit right now. That boy's pretty talented.
Man, Brent is a cool dude, man. I've chilled with him so many times in Dubai, and he's saying mine was a support verse, bro.
It was fire.
I mean, that's good. Now I know that Brent, on my previous, on my last episode, when I was getting the chef on board, he contacted me. He's like, man, that's amazing, because he's a chef as well, so he has a culinary background. So he's like, man, I'm really excited for this. And Brent is one of the supporters of this channel. Thank you very much, Brent. And
if there's anybody that's more of a jack of a trade than I am, it's probably Brent. You should know that.
And Salman, my college friend, is in the house. Salman, what's up, man? Thank you very much for tuning in. He's saying, is he the same guy who does modeling for Splash?
Oh my God! I knew somebody would say it. If this is the same Salman we know.
No. That's not the Salman you know. This is another Salman.
Okay, so yeah, so for the past year and a half, I've been sort of keeping myself somewhat afloat without the help of family through plus size modeling.
Plus size modeling.
Yeah, I'm a big boy, and so I'm just gonna go ahead and say that.
Yeah, but your physique is good because you're tall and stuff. So it, you know.
Pause. I appreciate it.
It compliments it, bro.
Yes, sir. No, it's just something that's it's not, it's super less, like no hassle at all. I just stand and pose and I get paid. So.
Which is good, man. Which is freaking good, man.
Listen, you gotta do what you gotta do.
So you are the guy who did the splash modeling.
Yeah. Special thank you to your friend for mentioning that. good job, Salman.
Salman, thank you very much. And Brent is saying he's just a jack.
Okay.
Man, freaking man, I miss it. Like, you know, this feels like a hangout. It's just, you know, we're, you know, in our comfort in our houses, and you know, we're just, you know, chilling, and it's so good that we have our friends over, and you know, they're watching us. It's like a gathering. It's just, you know,
that's just how great your podcast is, bro. That's just, you just gotta accept it.
Yeah, and Salman is saying, yep, plus size modeling looks like you have lost so much, XXL to XL.
My guy, he's trying to win me back with that comment. No, I appreciate it. Yeah, that's another project that I'm releasing in a couple of months. You guys have to wait to see that.
I mean, that's great, man. That's great. I mean, from modeling to rapping, you know, being an artist itself, it gives you that extra push, you know. It gives you that extra motive to do another things, you know. It opens up your brain to other things, you know, to... like, for me, this podcast, it helped me to talk a bit more and, you know... And like, you know, I've never been a camera shy guy. I've never, you won't believe it. I've never had stage fright. Like, I remember first time, like once I had stage fright, but that wasn't a stage fright in my opinion. It was just much more of an excitement when I was opening for Nickelback with my old band Nicotine. And I was like,
okay.
I was changing diapers every minute. I'm like, dude, Nickelback, dude, I came so long. Like, I'm like, this was a far-fetched dream for me to open for an international band, and being Nickelback, I was like, man, right. Damn, you know. But it wasn't a stage fright. I was actually so pumped up to go on stage and just, you know, kick it off. So
yeah.
Such things, it gives me that extra push to go ahead and learn more, like, you know, get to know other people, get knowledge from them, which is the main factor and the main reason I did this show. To, you know, we talk about the same like the same topics that we share, the same interest, and like with the, like, you know like-minded people, and we learn from each other. That's the whole point I'm trying to make.
For sure. I'm with you on that.
Yeah, man. So you know what, let's hit it to the video Stray Dog, and after that you talk about the video for a bit, and then we're going to kick it to the rapid fire rounds, which is the trivia section that I'm going to be, it's like a gaming section I do with my guests, so it's going to be fun. So let's hit it to the video. So
okay,
guys, this is Stray Dog. Enjoy.
Take a piss, I'm marking territories. Lift the bag, I'm like an inch away from barking. All these bottled up emotions, man, I'm howling, going slowly crazy. I'm not a cog in this machine of your systemic values. I'm just a dog that's gone astray from all that life has taught him. I'm unpredictable as you approach, proceed with caution. The hand that feeds has also always been the one that causes pain. Neglected, total shame, enslaving all these fucking brains. Watch out for all these fakes who work for nothing but their gains. Be the hunter, not the prey, or the one who wills to save all the weak from being taken by the evil and their ways. The world is fucking strange and it's been nothing but this way. Just learn to play the game, understand instead of pray. Knowing there's a factor in this life that helps you tame all the harshness of this world, yeah, you can pet the fucking mane. Go dancing with the flames, fortune favors all the brave. When you feel like life has put you down too much, understand that you know better, now don't lose touch. Please know that you are not alone, knowing that the world can be really fucking cold, yeah. When you feel like life has put you down too much, understand that you know better, now don't lose touch. Please know. You are not alone, knowing that the world can be really fucking cold, yeah.
So Hadi, such a great video, man. Such a great video. So chill. The beat is fire, man. The beat is super cool, man. So
yeah, it's a beat around on YouTube. So I think Beatles is the name of the producer.
So walk us through, man. What is the song about?
So the song is basically I am the stray dog. Just me talking about how I don't fit into any sort of like societal structure that a lot of people find themselves in, mm-hmm. mainly because of, you know, my background and my history. And so I sort of like talk about how it feels like I'm just a dog that's gone astray. And then I talk about sort of like my experiences with trusting people who end up not being who they are. Mm-hmm. And I said something about how the hand that feeds has also been the one that causes pain. And so a lot of metaphorical wordplay with how, you know, sometimes the world can be rough. And then in the end, I kind of just, the hook just basically goes, a lot of people may sometimes feel alone. And, you know, when they start realizing that the world can be pretty cruel, mm-hmm. and sort of just me reminding them that there are so many people who feel the same. And just knowing that fact, I feel gives a little comfort to anybody going through a rough time. So yeah, that's pretty much it. And the location, it was super funny story. So one of my super close friends from the States, mm-hmm. Shout out to Melanie. This was in New Mexico. I had traveled from California to go stay with her family for a week before I flew out, mm-hmm. came back here. And that is a sort of like a museum / I don't know how to explain it, fun house called, what's the name of that place? Oh, I forget the name of that place. But it's like this, it's an attraction that people go to.
In New Mexico. Okay.
And so we saw it online, and I was like, yeah, I have a song, and we just get our camera, and if we get tickets to go to this place, we'll just shoot inside this place. And so we just shot a bunch of takes at all mm-hmm. these random cool, super cool places, like backdrops. Mm-hmm. We had no lighting, no nothing. I had to teach her how to move the camera around.
Yeah, and, yeah.
I think it came out pretty dope, just, you know, in terms of it being low budget. And that's one of the songs that I push out there when somebody wants to get introduced to my music, because that's I feel like that's a good representation of me as a rapper as a whole. So yeah.
Well, man, the video is fucking dope. I know it's like there is something about you, and I think this is a new thing. I mean, it might not be a new thing, but I've seen it. I've seen you doing it. It's like you are presenting your music in like short length videos.
Uh-huh.
And that's a very, very catchy approach, because it doesn't it's like it doesn't bore the like, you know, the person who's listening. And it's you as you keep it funny as well. Sometimes it depends on the mood of the song, which what I'm trying to say, like, this idea, it's really, really awesome, and it really can catch on, you know. And kudos to you, man.
Thank you. No, that's just basically me playing with people's attention span, mm-hmm. and how, you know, everything right now is under a minute. And so you just got to sort of take advantage of that. And I considered Instagram to be my main platform for mm-hmm. like the past 2 years. And since you can post a minute's worth of videos on Instagram, mm-hmm. that just became my thing.
Yeah.
And so... Which, yeah, and it's more of like a, it's not bait, it's more of like, if you like the sound, then, you know, follow for more kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And eventually, once the numbers have reached a, you know, pretty reasonable count, then I'll start introducing full length songs and, mm-hmm. you know, go on from there. But I think that's my niche for them right now, for just like short.
Man, you're doing great. And even Brent is saying the teasers really work. Like, it's not actually a teaser. You're actually like presenting the whole song. But, you know, that small length, that short length, it really gives that, the full picture to the listener, to, mm-hmm. you know, in case if there is like a full length or like a full package song with the video.
Yeah.
So it's a very good approach to it, man. It's amazing. So kudos to you, man. Just keep doing that, and you're gonna, I hope I see you on larger scale fucking stages, man, one day. And as you know, Salman, you remember I was telling you the whole small group that, you know, how people know each other. Salman doesn't know you. So, but he, now he just tuned in the show and he knew you through, you are the Splash model. And
right.
I mean, you see what I'm trying to say. The connection is very like, you know, like you've never seen this coming. Yeah.
For sure. Yeah. Didn't expect to hear the Splash model thing again for the third time, but all right.
So, man, let's head it to the rapid fire rounds, which I'm going to be presenting you with two options, and you can choose whichever you want, and you can elaborate on your chosen one. And for the guys who are still watching, thank you very much for still tuning in. Please share this video with your friends. Do some share some love with me. Sorry again for the stammers. I'm getting used to it. So share this with your friends. Let them know about the page. Let's get more traffic into the page. And Hadi, are you ready, bro?
Let's do it, man.
So first one, I will explain it to you. As in, rap always got a bad reputation, as in lack of musicality. Yes or no?
No.
Oh, okay. And so, okay, moving on. Tupac or Biggie?
Biggie.
And yeah, just a shout out to the guys. You guys can join in the comment section with your answers. Let's have fun together, man. I want to know what you guys think. So join in with your answers in the comment section. So, moving on, Twista or Busta Rhymes?
I've heard more Busta Rhymes songs. I'm gonna go with Busta Rhymes.
Okay. On this next one, I want you to like elaborate a bit, because me personally, I don't consider this talent at all. Mumble rap is good or no?
That's an opinion question. I don't like it, but it works. So it doesn't, I don't think it matters what I think.
So I mean in my opinion, the beats are cool. Like the beats are really dope.
That's the whole elevated. So I think right now hip hop is in a state of moving back and forth from different kinds of music. Mm-hmm. Or different tones.
Mm-hmm.
And mumble was a huge, like a huge part of the body of hip hop for a while. And now I think it's coming back towards lyricism and just, you know, the bars. But it doesn't matter really. It's gonna grow whichever way it grows, and people will like what they hear, you know?
It's just a matter that, you know, you're not understanding. I mean, one of the most famous ones is Designer, and his song Panda, I mean, that song is really legit, like legitly nice, but the way he mumble raps, it's nice, but again, it's very few, you know, they're like few of them that you enjoy their music, like, you know, Designer being one of them. But again, it's just crazy. I don't know, man. I mean, I'm talking as
You'd be surprised. You'd be surprised. The swarms of the fans and the kids, the thousands of kids who love this music.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You'd be surprised.
Yeah. It's
so, like, at the end of the day, and I tell this to, actually, I had this conversation with another person who's been trying to do music as well, because he's been trying to fit some sort of like narrative. And this is a problem that a lot of people go through in their like adolescent artist years. But honestly speaking, and I have this conversation with so many people, it does not matter at the end of the day. If you put out something that you yourself are good at, that makes sense to you, that's all that counts. Because at the end of the day, people will like whatever they like. Do you know what I mean?
So yeah, I get it.
In terms of content creation, like let's say there's another person doing a podcast, and where all he talks about is cups, let's say, for example, right? I find that topic boring, but let's just say his podcast blows and he has thousands and thousands of viewers and listeners because they all like cups. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, I get it.
So it really doesn't matter. In terms of what you want to put out there, just as long as you're genuine about it, because people can see through bullshit pretty easy nowadays. So just be genuine about whatever you put out and you'll be fine. And a lot of these mumble, you know, rappers, that's how they are. That's how they feel. That's how they rap. That's what they like. And then there are kids who identify with that as well. And so, man, they make millions. And mm-hmm. respect to them for getting paid. It's not my style at the end of the day, but it is what it is.
Man, there's some interesting options from the guys. Brent is saying Busta. Ramsey is saying Biggie for sure. Brent is saying good. Ramsey is saying mumble rap ain't for me, but sometimes it's just vibes. And Brent is saying mumble is a lot of feel. And he's adding to it a lot of psychology goes with how music evolves naturally. Mm-hmm. And it's crazy how just as a hectic life is now, the type of calm people look for are equality and as extreme. So mumble for me makes sense, and it's a way in keeping with the times. Really, bro, Brent?
Facts. Oh, I think that's facts. Yeah. No, I think that's facts because it's, again, like a lot of people, especially over here, you only see what you see. You only see what you're shown. Mm-hmm. And when you walk around and become a part of the culture from where it's originated and mm-hmm. see how things are, mm-hmm. Pretty sure you get culture shocked because it's huge. It's absolutely huge. Just because we don't see it over here doesn't mean that it's not happening. Mm-hmm. And you just have to adapt, really. And I say this for all those who are born in the 90s and 80s. If you don't know how to adapt, if you can't adapt, you're not going to make it. So you're not going to make it far.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you just really have to adapt. And you have to, and in most cases, I could feel otherwise maybe a little later on, but in most cases, you have to be accepting of whatever the situation is.
Mm-hmm.
And still find a way to do your thing, man. Do it around it, over it, whatever the case may be.
Yeah, man, that's great. I mean, you know, it's nice that we can have these talks, you know, and you know, help each other to understand stuff a bit more. Like, yeah, sure. As I said, for me, it's also much more of the vibes. The beats are very fire; they're very good. But when that guy starts just mumbling, and I'm like, man, seriously, yeah, like you're butchering the whole thing. Like, I wish Eminem was like, you know, freestyling on this thing. You know?
Oh, that's how you feel, you know?
Yeah, I know. It's a very acquired taste. It's an acquired taste. So, moving on. Rappers diss each other for marketing. Yes or no?
Yes and no.
Which, to what extent, yes?
Is
it okay? I mean, because one of my friends who, as I told you, my cousin, he's a huge-ass rapper. Not a huge-ass rapper, like he's a fan of rap. So, he told me, like, this whole dissing thing is kind of a contract between two of them. It's like, okay, you diss me, and you can get, you know, more publicity.
Yeah, that's very plausible, and most of the times that's pretty much what happens. You have to dig deep, really, into whatever beef is happening. You really have to dig deep, and because it's with labels, you have both sides talking to each other. Sometimes the artists will directly speak to each other. Sometimes they'll meet somewhere,
mm-hmm.
and at the end of the day. At the end of the day, if you don't look at it as just healthy competition, then you're looking at it from, you know, from a different perspective. I just look at it as healthy competition.
Mm-hmm.
If somebody out of the blue starts dissing me, I'll realize that my music is being
turning heads,
and I'll just look at it as a way for me to step my game up. Sharpen up my lyrics and go back and see who has the best bars, and so which goes back to me saying everything is kind of subjective in terms of there are no actual, I don't know, there's mm-hmm. there's the basic rules of rap beef. Obviously, if you have better cadence, you have better flow, you have better bars, but at the end of the day, also it's healthy competition, really.
Mm-hmm.
If it gets escalated, then that's on them, really. I'm you know.
That's all different. Good. I just want to let everyone know. I mean, if you guys want to like add anything to the comment section, tell us how you feel about this. Like, you know, this, you know, rappers dissing each other, or in general, like, you know, that whole competitive nature. Yeah,
it's great.
Yeah. So moving on, real rap is about struggle. Yes or no?
Again, yes and no. I mean, it originated from that. Mm-hmm. Sure, but it's evolved, just like what Brent said earlier. Also, it's evolved, and every year there's just a different aspect and a different branch that grows. Mm-hmm. This is all coming from, you know, personal experiences and just views. Everything's anecdotal subjective in this sense. Mm-hmm. So in it started off with sort of rapping. Well, rapping was basically an escape from your reality, right? Mm-hmm. And the realities back then were not so pretty, mm-hmm. right? So that's basically been my vehicle for the longest time. I rap to escape my realities. Mm-hmm. I talk about my realities through the metaphors in my songs. And so that's a huge aspect of it. But then it also is, it's a battle of who, you know, it's a battle of wits, who has the better bars, who has the nicer flow. You know, that's why you hear all the rappers say that they're the best, because that's part of it. That comes with it. Mm-hmm. And like we said earlier, it evolves and it becomes more than it is. And so right now, you know, you'll see, like you said, you like the vibes of the beats, you know, mm-hmm. you fuck with the instrumental, so you can hear a catchy tune. So it's diverse now. That's pretty much what it's become. But I do believe that it originated from, what do you say, hard times?
You know, talking about like, you know, yeah, as like, you know, the struggle and stuff like this, you know.
Of course.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Ramsey is saying, dissing is good, but I think rap has to go back to sending a message and telling stories instead of just showing off.
Again, that's how he feels. Mm. That's the thing. I don't know. Like, this is always the topic of a conversation. Mm. Somebody will say it shouldn't be like this and it shouldn't be like that. Mm. And respect to you for having your opinion. That's cool. A lot of people feel the same way you feel. Mm-hmm. And then you'll have to just brace yourself, because you'll find on the other side of the pond, so many people feel another way. So, and then, but here's the thing, the beautiful thing about music, mm-hmm. Is that it's an ocean, right? And if you don't like how something sounds, you can swim in another direction and you'll eventually find something you do like. So the fact that it's open enough for you to find things that you kind of find, you know, like common grounds with, or mm-hmm. that you are attracted to, mm-hmm. that's the best thing about it. But yeah, I will stand with both Ramsey and
Brent
in terms of it evolves crazily, mm-hmm. but I do also like the whole point of sending out a message. Mm-hmm. But there's so many artists and there's so much music.
Yep.
And you'll definitely find what you're looking for if you just look in the right places, 100%.
And okay, moving on. Nicki Minaj or Iggy Azalea?
Nicki Minaj.
Dude, which her stuff is really dope. Some of her stuff is really dope. I really enjoy it. I mean, aside of that whole, My Anaconda.
Most rappers, most mainstream rappers, if you dig deep enough, you can find mixtapes from before they actually got famous, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah, yeah.
It's usually these mixtapes that are so fun. Because mainstream music is also a different branch. Mm-hmm. Mainstream hip hop is also a different branch, but you know they're there for a reason, and you can't deny the fact that they have the talent for it. So I'll go with Nicki. Those are the two choices. I'll go
yep. moving on. 50 Cent or The Game?
Oh, that's tough. I haven't listened to enough songs to make a decision.
Hmm.
I'll go with 50 Cent, just as a whole, as an artist and as a personality.
Mm-hmm. I mean,
a few L's.
And Brent is saying, yeah, Nicki still has an OG feel. Yeah, she can rap. She can really laugh, like, you know, proper, like, you know. And then Ramsey's saying, dude, Nicki is fire. She's the best feature artist right now. She's the only reason I still listen to Takeshi 69, man. And yeah, Takashi, whatever, man. I don't get that guy at all, man. I mean, and then Brent is saying 50 Cent via Yachi. That's it. Yeah, man. So I mean, yeah, again, yeah, for me, I still like, yeah, Nicki is fucking dope, man. I really like her shit. But yeah, so you said The Game. So moving on, conscious rap or gangster rap?
Conscious rap.
Mm. Moving up, rap can be misunderstood. Yes or no?
Yeah, all the time. All the time.
Okay, moving on. Tech N9ne or Bone Thugs and Harmony?
Bone Bone Thugs is classic, but I've heard more Tech N9ne songs. Again, like, I'm not your everyday artist. This is probably the most boring thing about me, is I don't invest so much in albums, and I don't listen to, this is the weird thing about me. I listen to just, if you look at my playlist, it's just so random.
Mm-hmm.
And it's whatever I can get my hands on. Sometimes I'll have some stuff in repeat, but if we're talking catalogs, I have such poor repertoire when it comes to catalogs. But I'll go with Tech N9ne because I know more songs. But I know that Bone Thugs is
one of the OGs in this league.
Oh, yeah, OG for sure.
So moving on, rap producers are the reason for having so many shitty rappers. Yes or no?
Oh, this is the first time I heard that. I'm going to say no.
Isn't the money factor?
What do you mean?
As in, just to make cash, they just, you know, give them a fire beat and the guy goes and butchers the song.
Again, that's what's considered a butchered song. You know what I mean? Like, you said you don't like Tekashi 6ix9ine, right?
For example, I will give you another instance.
That's the best example. You said you don't like Tekashi 6ix9ine, right?
Mm-hmm. It's not that I don't like him, I don't know the guy personally, it's just that his
you don't get him,
right? Yeah, his music is just weird. I mean, another guy who I don't get it is, like, I think he just had a one hit wonder and it was just blow off because it was just funny to watch. It was I'm in love with the Coco.
Okay.
I mean, the beat was good and the guy was just, first of all, the lyrics, the whole concept behind it was just gibberish, and the way he was doing it was freaking gibberish.
You know what he means when he says something?
Yes, I know. But again, I mean, for me, these type of person, like, you know, this type of musicians, okay, let's put them all in that pot of musicians. Mm-hmm. There is something wrong, man. I mean, for me, because music is such a divine topic, I don't consider these things as music.
Right. Well, I mean, if you were the person that was in charge of whether or not it was considered music, then I guess they wouldn't be around. But
exactly. No, I'm saying this because we're sharing information. This is how I feel about it, you know.
Right. Yeah. For sure. No, I mean that's okay. That's understood, and that's without being said, it's a given, right? Mm-hmm. For sure. But at the end of the day, if you don't like something, that doesn't mean it's not going to
do good. 150%. Obviously, there's other people who like this type of things, but I'm talking as a musician. You know, we're talking, like, now we're like, you know, dissecting the whole thing. We're breaking it down, you know.
So instead of not liking them, how would you feel if I asked you to maybe respect them?
Which there is. I do respect them, but for me, when it comes and they say, okay, for example, the Coco dude, or like this Tekashi 6ix9ine, I mean, like, man, seriously, there is so many other artists that they're doing way more things that is more valuable to you as a human being, and they're teaching you something educational, which this guy is just with his rainbow dreads, and, you know, it's just...
I mean, do you have to listen to a lot of... You have to go deeper than that, really, because this is another case of you're being flashed certain images, and then you're sort of being ushered into feeling a certain way.
I mean, I am upfront when it comes to talking about my feelings regarding music, because music is one of the, like, if not the only thing that is the most, like, it's so dear to my heart, because this is how I deal with my music. I try to make sure the listener feels the thing that I'm trying to say. But I don't know, dude, it's not that I'm saying I am, like, I'm 100% right, but I am mistaken. But I'm just sharing this information with you. So I mean,
I want to take this mentality, and this is from a lot of people as well. And I'm not trying to change the way you think. I'm not trying to sway you to think the opposite. I just want to put this option out on the table, in where you just view it for what it is and just let it be. You know what I mean?
Exactly.
Like when I was younger, for example, or when I just started out, right?
Mm-hmm.
I feel like I have the best work ethic. This is my personal feeling, right?
Mm-hmm.
I feel like I have the best work ethic amongst all my peers and all the people who are trying to do what I do, right? And if somebody puts out something and it gets really big and they explode and they make money off of it, I used to get bitter about it. I used to feel, God damn it, I write every single day. I make sense in my lyrics. I'm funny. I have a personality. That's how I used to think, right? But at the end of the day, it's just, it's a matter of time, a matter of luck. You know, sometimes it's political, who you know, what you can do. And eventually, you know, with the work ethic you put into whatever it is you're doing, you'll get to where you, you know, deserve to get to. So this is a great opportunity for me. If there are people that are watching that are artists as well, right? Don't, this is going to be really hard, right? Don't compare. Don't be bitter, right? Don't try to, as much as you can, because imitation is a form of flattery. We had this conversation the other day. As much as you can, just be genuine with the things that you put out and just be consistent with it, really. Because if somebody like, that's, and then my other point is, if somebody like Tekashi 6ix9ine, who you think is not worthy of the platform that he has, has gotten onto that platform, what makes it different for you? Why can't that mean you can get on the platform? Do you know what I'm saying?
So exactly, yes.
Maybe like the mindset should be more like, well, if this dude can do it, then damn, then I could definitely do it. So
well, basically it's it is that like live and let live, which we talked about. But I mean, I was talking about it a bit more on the music side. I mean, as I said, I mean, again, it's acquired taste. So I, you know what, I'll just shut up now. So moving on, old school beats or modernized beats?
That's tough. There are some days where I really feel like old school boom bops. I have a bunch of songs. Like even Stray Dog was an old school boom bop. And but I also love the new school beats. I love like a good trap beat or a good something with good drops. And it's it depends really on whether or not you're feeling a certain way. You know, some days I wake up and all I want to do is rap and boom bop beats. Other days I want to hear something like, you know, I don't know, Kid Cudi-ish. Kanye-ish.
I love Kid like what was his hit song? Kid is it Kid Cudi? Day and Night. I love that track, man.
Oh no, that's called, the name of that song is called something Stoner's Dream. See, this is why I'm terrible with
whoever knows with the song name, drop it in the comment section. Let's know the song, because it's been a while, man. It's like what, 2012 or 2011? That song is quite old.
Might even be before that.
Yeah, 2010 or something. So the last one, man, trap or no?
Say it again.
Trap beats or no?
Or no? Like, you mean like no?
Are you a fan of trap beats or no?
Oh, yeah, yeah, definitely. Definitely a fan of trap beats. 100%, yeah. Shout out to Lana and trap music. No, sorry, it is called Dana. It was from Man on the Moon. Yeah. 2009, so it wasn't.
Yeah, I told you, it was way back. I used to, I remember we used to jam it out in, like, you know, the clubs and stuff like this. Man, well, what you think we go hit it and listen to one of your other songs that it's kind of new, but, you know, it's been, like, you know, it's been there, like, you know, it's been out for a while, called the called Astronomical.
Yeah, so, for sure. That's one of my favorite songs.
Yes, so guys, enjoy it. We're going to be back in a few minutes.
Okay. Guess I'm just going to have to talk about it. Yeah. Look, I could say this started back in 2016. 26, never known for spitting 16s. But I had an idea, I just never had means. I grew up in a world where the thought was obscene. But I always had a knack for these bars like a prisoner. Always holding on, thinking maybe I was meant for the pen and pad. Never had any kind of habitat to put me in a mind state of calm, like how I am with rap. Like candle wax, it keeps the fire within intact. I feel relaxed, far from claustrophobic. I feel confident in my Alcatraz. With headphones on, spinning paragraphs. All over the mic, the booth becomes an avalanche. And before you know it, my thoughts are spread across the land. With no intentions, guess I'm just thinking out loud. Sure, it's a form of therapy, but like, don't you hear the sound? I think it's astronomical. Biases aside, I just feel like this shit is natural. And just to top it off, the boy was born with hella character. So why the fuck am I still gazing up at where I'm supposed to live? The story is, Far from complicated, matter of fact, it's straightforward. I just can't be blunt about it, hence the metaphor. And pay attention, I've been border jumping since I was 16. My roots were never permanent, home was a bad dream. Anywhere I slept, I just felt like an ET. I prayed for only one thing, to find people like me. Shit was frustrating. Now adapting to my surroundings was something that I did with ease. And through my forced expressions, I saw and observed routines. I learned the ways of man, the good, the bad, the ugly. I found that in the end, it's really just you that's in the casket. And that whether or not you care about the numbers at your funeral, you gon' end up living life on your own accord, period. I use these lessons on a daily when I'm on my grind, cause finding patience through frustration is a state of mind that not so many have. I won't succumb to being left behind. I just shake my head, take a few deep breaths, assess the situation and get back on my shit. I tell myself it makes the story all the more worth it, and I believe it, that's what makes the push more strong, I think. How is it? I can speak a language I was never exposed to. Directly all I had was visuals and these audios. Why do I feel comfortable in places where the blueprints suggest that I don't belong based on the structure of my footprints? I feel like where you've been is supposed to help with how you get there. I don't think expression is limited, so why the judgment? Why am I built differently? What do these struggles mean? Will I even live to see the outcome? I don't know. I just know that I am not done. A songbird that's fatigued, but I refuse to be outsung. So many plans since day one, and I don't plan to die before I cross off at least one. Time is of the essence, take advantage of the present. Keep the past somewhere safe and the future in view. It's not how fast I can get there, it's how much I endure. It's not the cash that I'm after, it's the principle too. And the fact that outsiders can participate too. I'm breaking barriers. I know there's others that feel the same but don't have access to the platforms that I've been trying to break since I got on. I'm the first of my kind, I'm what you trying to find, you just don't know it yet. Hence the constant content, I'm just knocking till somebody answers. And I ain't stopping till I've knocked on every door and countered. Which means I can't stay still, which means any time to kill for me, it's time for me to kill. I just gotta keep moving, I gotta keep moving. Can't get used to losing, I cannot stop. I just gotta keep moving, I gotta keep moving. Can't get used to losing, I cannot stop.
So, Hadi, man, tell us about that. Tell us about the video. And I mean, the video is much more of a lyric video. So tell us, what is the song about? As you said, this is regarding your, like, you know, the struggle and stuff like this. And so tell us more, man.
So that's pretty much my story, I guess. Pound Cake Freestyle. So I love so if you know Drake, that's from one of his songs, Jay-Z as well. And then Lil Dicky put out a freestyle, and I had to just jump on that because the beat was pretty astronomical. So it's basically just me explaining exactly how it started. So like in the beginning, I say you can say it started back in 2016. Mm-hmm. I was never known exactly for spitting bars, so I was never known for rap, and I just knew how it was done, and mm-hmm. I never knew that I could find so much solace in with the pen and pad, saying that it was. What did I say? Something about I feel comfortable in my Alcatraz, meaning so that's a lot of, I don't know if we get this wordplay. So bars, mm-hmm. we're training as a jail, so jail has bars, so I felt comfortable in my Alcatraz, in my little jail with all these bars. I felt the most comfortable with a pen and pad, basically. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And it started with me just, you know, spitting a lot of raps in the booth, which becomes an avalanche, basically just is me saying that I spread all my thoughts into the world with no intentions. And then I start saying, I don't know about you guys, but I actually think, this is of course a personal opinion, that my sound on beats sounds really good. So I feel like I sound astronomical, basically, is what I'm saying. Mm-hmm, and mm-hmm. then I talk about my struggles, and where I talk about not knowing where home is. And then I talk about the problems where I grew up in. And I sort of end it with, I will be the first of my kind. Just basically saying that there's nobody out there really that embraces, or just like, you know, comes from the same background as I do. And that I'm willing to break the platform and kind of like open the doors to people like me. And because I know there's so many people who are in the same boat, and yeah, it's a pretty
I mean, on that sorry if I cut you off on that segue, does the community or like does the community that we come from plays a very big role in our artistic side? Do you think that way?
I mean, it 100% has to, just in terms of, you know, building a personality for yourself or an artist, like an artistic character. Everything stems from experience, and everything, you know, it boils down to what you see and what you know.
Like the influence, like do we get like influenced by the behavior that we have in our communities or like, you know, the backgrounds that we have? Is it good? Is it good to show it in our art?
I mean, it depends on the artist, really. If you feel like that's something you want to express, then go for it. Again, there's no right or wrong. And somebody will view your art or your work just completely differently from another person. So this is why I keep saying, as long as you're genuine about it, it doesn't really matter. But huge part, definitely, if it comes to my music, you'll hear a lot of maybe angst. I don't want to say anger, it's just such a strong word, but you know, a lot of how I feel stems from where I grew up. And
yeah, the struggle. Yeah, the struggle.
Yeah, for sure.
So how hard was it for you to send this message across? Was it like you stopped yourself of saying a lot of things, or it was just an open world for you?
I look at it as a challenge, and I look at it as a way to sharpen my skills as a writer and as a person who can creatively put stories together through words. If you catch me in a conversation, or if I'm in a group and we're talking about something, and if it gets a little political, I might get lost with my thoughts, and sometimes I sound a little too overbearing, which is why I like the fact that with music I can sit down and arrange my thoughts and creatively play with the words in order to express how I feel. So I always look at it as a challenge, and it's the best kind of challenge because you get better. If you know, if there's something that can sharpen your skills, you know, dive into it and just be swallowed by the fact that you are challenged every second. I love that.
Was it, I mean, like take it this way, maybe because that understanding was not established in this community that we live in, maybe that's why you felt much more comfortable in the US, that people would understand you like better, and you know, it's easier for you to send your message across with, like, you know,
I speak their language.
No, as in like community, like, you know, background, like, you know, because when it comes to them, they're like much more flexible and open to different backgrounds, and they're not like, oh, this and that, this and that. But I mean, I meant it this way because that, I mean, we're facing it with the whole metal crew that we do, like, you know, rock and metal and stuff like this. That understanding is still not established here. They don't, they still, like, you know, they're kind of, you know, how to say it, on an edge when it comes to this, like, you know, they're like hesitant, but still, like, it's growing.
I think, you know, it's really exposure. First of all, this is a very small country, right? Second of all, the room for growth in terms of just creatively, even culturally, the ceiling is a very low ceiling. The fact that you can't really have generations of something because of the whole, if you're not from here, then after a certain time, you're gonna have to leave, right? So it's always like a renewal, you could say, of people or of culture. But then as time progresses, of course, and as technology increases, and as you know, we become more exposed to more things, there is a growth. But it's just not as natural or as like this, the speed of the growth is it varies, you know, and it's that's, I don't know how to explain it. There's even you know, a lack of expression because, you know, like I said before, we're not fully able to freely express, and that's a huge part of the whole, whether or not you're making music or you're in any kind of art form. The whole point of it is to express, really. That's why I left at a young age. And I'm not saying anything against the people who are trying to do things over here, but if you have to realize that these are the things that are holding you back. And kudos to all those who challenge And we try to push the envelope on a daily basis, but you can only push it so far. And if you're not looking after yourself first, then it'll be really hard. So there's so many things that are holding, because I can go ahead on record and say that there are so many talents here that have just given the space and freedom to work on themselves and to improve. It, just like my song, they'll be astronomical. But it's just, you know, things that we can't really talk about that hold the talents back. But I think I lost. I don't know what the question was.
You are on the same question. It's just like, yeah, as I said, that understanding still, it's not established. It's not
by the understanding. Right?
Yeah. So it's for them. It's they're kind of hesitant, you know, to let go or like, you know, for example, like I always say this, like when I was a bassist in my band, my dad was always telling me, oh, so finally you're a dancer. I'm like, thank you very much, Dad. This is how you've, like, you know, for him to understand it, it's like, you know, it's on a different level. But for me, if I want to explain that to him, it's going to take me a longer time because...
Well, you have your generational gap, you have your cultural gap.
Yeah.
Of course, you have just the things that you're exposed to is completely different. Mm-hmm. Very, very, very different. Like in the Western world, everybody's around the same thing pretty much all throughout.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, growth is that. This is what I mean by having no identity and just being culturally lost. Everything is all over the place, and that's why you find little groups and little communities like the metal, like the rock and metal, you know, community that you're a part of. All of you kind of just grow together because you guys are in the same boat, and there's not a lot of room on the boat for more people because of the, you know, you were given that boat, is you know, metaphorically speaking. But again, it's very small. It's very small. And is there growth? Sure. I'll say that there's growth. Will we be alive to see the amount of understanding that we wish to see now? I don't think so. I don't think so. But that's how it is. That's why.
But you know what? Whoever's still watching, please let us know what you think. Does the community, like the whole influence from the community, really affects our art? Should it affect our art? It should be this way, or it's like that whole understanding should be there and everyone should get along. So you know what, I wanted really to talk to you about the, like, some of the female rappers in the game, man. And you know, earlier today I told you, if you know Snow the Product,
yeah,
this chick is super dope, man. I mean, like, she gives me the early vibes of Missy Elliott, like, you know, that whole gangster thing. Yeah. But you know, it's so modernized, and but she's like, you know, she's still so old school. Like, she's a good combination of both. And I mean, she's, I think I would keep like Nicki and Snow the Product like on the same thing, but I would root for Snow the Product. Like, okay, what is your take on the female rappers, how they're doing? Like, do you have any favorites, or like tell us what you feel about it.
I mean, one of the first tracks that I jumped on in terms of putting something out there, like as a project, was a song that I remixed by a female rapper. Her name is Lady LaSure. She's an English rapper. Great lyricist. And I totally just vibe with her music. And so, yeah, she was one of the reasons, one of the pushes I had to jump into the game was because of a female rapper. I don't listen to too many female rappers. One, because I need more. We need more female rappers in the game.
Mm-hmm.
So you need to step up. Two, my knowledge of female rap. I know Snow the Product is a Latino rapper. I think she's a West Coast rapper also. Mm-hmm. And you have like MC Light. You have, like, back in the days, you had Lil' Kim, you had Lil' Mama, and you had, and now there is a wave of new artists that are coming on. I was having this conversation the other day about what's her name? She was a meme, and now she has like a whole album, and she's doing really good. I keep forgetting, but
you're talking about Cash Me Outside Girl?
No, but she's also an artist. Doja Cat is who I'm talking about. And just the effects that they have on pop culture right now. Now is a great time for all the female artists to come out. And with social media, with everything that's going on right now, everything is on full blast. So We definitely need more artists. I'd definitely like to be in a situation where I can be more comfortable talking about artists. So like, see, right now I'm kind of like trying to think of female artists. I don't want that to be the case. I do know that there are so many other dope female artists who are on the comp as well. Shout out to Athena, one of my peers from LA, who's mm-hmm. also trying to make it. But we need more. That's what I can say about that. If you guys are hiding, come out. Put your stuff out online. Publish
yeah.
your music.
Yeah, man, dude. ASAP. I mean, yeah, female artists. I mean, like, you know, female rappers, they can bring better flair to the game. Like, seriously, uh-huh. man. I mean, like, they're really good. Like, I really felt it. Like, you know, they add a lot of... it's just a different take. I mean, I don't know. I feel it that way. And it's really good. Yeah. I mean, again, like... I've never been, like, you know, so in touch with rap, which, I mean, again, rap was still one of my favorite genres, like, of music. I really enjoy rap. And, but I, you know, as I told you off here, I'm much more of, like, a rap metal dude. Like, I enjoy it in that format. Because it gives
Rage Against the Machine.
Right, I mean, again, as I told you, I cannot put Rage as a rap metal band, because you know what, you can say they were the pioneers and they paved the way for other bands, such as, like, let's say one of the pioneers of rap metal bands, you know, let's say Limp Bizkit. Yeah, so I like it in that format, you know, like, you know, that whole heaviness and, like, you know, adding the you know, that groovy guitars and, you know, that that aggressive, energetic vibe mm-hmm. that it makes you move, you know. It really, really, really gave me the feels, you know. That's how sure. I like it. But for me, Tupac is one of the greatest. Eminem, you know, NWA, Snoop Dogg, Cypress Hill, Sendog, and Be Real, and these guys are still the main, like, you know,
right, all old school yeah, artists. Yeah,
like, you know, if you know the band called the it was an affiliation with Be Real, it called the Psycho Realm.
Okay, I don't know them.
Man, they're like a Mexican, like, you know, Cypress Hill, but, you know, full-on gangster rap. Dude, mm-hmm. you need to check them out. I mean, they are crazy. They're super good. And they're way right. old. They're way old, like, back in the days. So, man, I always ask my guest at the end of the, you know, before we wrap it up, what is next for the rap game?
For the rap game itself?
I mean, for the rap music, or you, yourself, what do you see? What's next? What is your vision of it?
I don't know. I wouldn't be me if I didn't say I'm next. So, you know, rap game, better watch out. Yeah. No, look, it's growing every single day. Mm-hmm. There's no saying as to what could be a hit tomorrow, you know, compared to what's a hit today. And I think that's the best part of it. It's so flexible. And it's open. It's not, now it's more open to just, you can hear just pop vibes, acoustic vibes, rock vibes. And it's just, it's growing. So I like it. You know, there's so many people who don't, but I think it's in a good place. You know, there was an era where, you know, hip hop was dead was something that people said, and it's very much alive now, mm-hmm. pretty much in the lead. Taking over all the time. And so I think it's going to stay on top for a long time, and which is good for people like me, because then that would just give me more push, like our boys said, and to go get it.
And Brent is saying Insane Clown Posse, man, these guys are amazing. Have you heard Insane Clown Posse?
Nope.
You never heard ICP, man? Wow. They're genre called horror hop.
Okay.
They're like, you know, take that metal feel, but put it in rap. And right. they're just like crazy. I mean, they call themselves the Juggalos. So, mm-hmm. I mean,
Juggalos.
Do you know Head PE?
Head PE, no.
Again, like Head PE, it's like, you know, from the same group. Do you know Cottonmouth mm-hmm. Kings?
No, not
yeah,
any of these.
Yeah, dude, these guys are very, like, you know, they have that punk rock and, like, you know, Head P is like a punk rock mixed with metal, mixed with rap. And the guy has, like, very, very talented voice. Like, he can do, like, Michael Jackson type of stuff. He can do R&B. He can do screaming. Gotcha. He can do rapping. He's crazy, man. I will send you a few links and you can see them, man. And, right. Man, that's great.
That's what I mean. That's what I mean, though. Like, it's so vast and so diverse. That's just what makes it you know, all the more attractive to the viewer.
Yeah, man. And Brent is saying Notorious B.I.G. Yes, bro. I mean, Biggie was one of the pioneers of these things. And man, again, man, it's a very broad topic to talk about. Again, as you said, different tastes and stuff like this plays a huge ass role in this. It's like anything else. And that's the beauty, yeah, in my opinion, that you have different people with different ideas about the thing and how they approach it, and which you are approaching it in a different way by putting mm-hmm. your own spin to it, as in like the tiny videos, and you just wrap it up in a very funny thing sometimes. And dude, kudos to you. I hope you keep doing it, and I hope to see you soon on a like larger stages, and hopefully this whole yeah. thing opens up so I can see you perform. And see
It'll
you
happen.
See yeah. you do more modeling for Splash and
ooh, fourth time you said that.
Man, it was a blast having you on the show, man.
Thanks for having me, man. Congratulations again on your milestone.
Still working on it, man. Still there's a lot of content coming your way, guys. And dude, for final words, where they can find you?
Oh, all over. I actually have a growing fan base on TikTok, which is something that not a lot of people know. I had a song that kind of just went viral. It's on 120K views now.
Damn,
so
man.
Definitely find me on TikTok. It's just my full name, Hadi Rushdie. Mm-hmm. Hadi Rushdie, however you want to pronounce it. And then on Instagram, it's the same, Hadi Rushdie as well. SoundCloud, just type in Hyped Hads, HypedHadz. YouTube as well, The Bearded Kid, or just type in my name. Mm. All my stuff is all over on Spotify. It's just Hadi, but you're gonna have to search through a bunch of Hadis to find my two songs that are up there. Mm. And yeah, that's pretty much it. I'm online every single day, and I'm working on posting at least a track a day for the next few months. So if you guys are in for that, then it's gonna be a heck of a ride. So yeah.
So you guys heard the main guy, where to find him. I already put your Instagram handle and your Facebook handle on the page. So,
no.
Hadi, any final words you want to say to the people who are still watching?
Yeah, be safe. Just keep trying to better yourself, really. It's cliche, but what else can I say, really? Follow me, man. Follow me.
Yeah, follow him on TikTok. Follow him on Instagram and Facebook and other on YouTube as well, The Bearded Kid. And I'm sure you have a lot of more content coming soon. So I'm looking forward, man. Dude, again, thank you very much for sticking around
thank
with
you.
Me, man. Thank you very much for coming on the show. It means the world to me. I really had a blast talking to you and, like, you know, digging down a bit of information from you, because that's what I usually do with the guest. And
yes, sir.
Man, I hope I did justice to you. And again, thank you very much for whoever's like still watching. Share this video with your friends. Tell your mama, tell your daddy. Tell everyone you know. Tell everyone you know about this page. Let's get more traffic into the page. And if you guys are interested to get your illustration, like the one I have in the starting of the show, please contact Bundlehead on Instagram. I'm going to be putting his link in the caption later after we're off air. If you're interested in such things, please contact the guy. The guy is phenomenal when it comes to these type of, you know, caricatures and funny looking stuff. So if you want to get yourself one of these, contact the guy. The guy is really cool and down to earth. And again, thank you very much, Hadi. I'll catch you on the flip side, and I'll see you soon, man. Take care, guys. Have fun.